viewers. In Goa, we are incredibly fortunate to have a returning turtle population, our own coral reef, mangrove forests, khazan lands, beautiful beaches, riverine islands, a resident dolphin population, and transient whales that visit our waters. It is timely that His Holiness calls for our active commitment to protecting our oceans. I'm Nandini Velio, a wildlife biologist, and together with a social scientist, we have worked on drafting a message that has been circulated in churches about Goa's oceans. His Holiness Pope Francis released his message for the month of September, where he invites us to pray that politicians, scientists, and economists work together to protect the world's seas and oceans.
Buen día. Hoy les quisiera hablar de algo que es muy importante y me pesa en el corazón. Hablar de los océanos. Los océanos contienen la mayor cantidad del agua del planeta y también la mayor variedad de seres vivientes. Muchos de ellos amenazados por diversas causas. Y no nos damos cuenta o no nos queremos hacer cargo. No olvidemos que de dos respiraciones que yo hago, una es por los océanos. Hace un mes recibí un grupo de pescadores. Siete de ellos me dijeron lo siguiente. En los últimos meses recogimos 6 toneladas de plástico. Eso es la muerte de los océanos, es la muerte del todo viviente, es mi muerte. Creación es un proyecto de amor de Dios hacia la humanidad. Un enfoque interdisciplinario para afrontar las amenazas causadas por la gestión injusta de nuestros mares nos va a ayudar a afrontar este gran desafío. Y aquí se juega nuestra supervivencia. Nuestra solidaridad con la casa común nace de nuestra fe. Recemos para que los políticos, los científicos, los economistas trabajen juntos por la protección de los mares y de los océanos.
God gave us a beautiful, bountiful garden, but we have turned it into a polluted wasteland of debris, desolation, and filth, he said. The world's oceans cover more than 2/3 of our planet's surface and occupies a vast 3-dimensional volume that sustains a tremendous population in diverse ways. For us in Goa, the sea is intrinsic to our culture and daily life and has formed the marker of our identity, from our music to our sheet, kodi, and niste. We celebrate Sangod in honor of Saint Peter, who is the patron saint of our fishers. Today, our oceans are under threat because of our actions over the last 100 years. Our global demands for seafood, our consumption levels, and our pursuit for endless economic growth has pillaged and polluted and changed the very nature of our oceans. With the increase of tropical storms, dropping fish catch, high levels of erosion, our lives here on the Goan coast will be directly affected. For instance, the shinanios of our childhood have almost disappeared and our prawns are becoming smaller and smaller. From 1990 to 2000, in just 10 years, prawn catches have fallen by 80% in Goa. We ordinary citizens who live on the coast have a responsibility, and we can use these simple steps to take direct measures to safeguard this resource that sustains us. Fish. How we love our ambotik and curry, but can we choose the right fish in our Goan food dishes? The answer is that there are now seafood calendars that help us know about our fish. For instance, inseasonfish.com and Know Your Fish gives us a monthly list of fish to avoid according to their breeding times. It's not about just eating the right fish, but also catching them according to the best season and avoiding more destructive ways of fishermen. Fishers are encouraged to use larger mesh size nets, as small nets catch too many juveniles and bycatch, which are species that are not consumed. Species like sharks, turtles, rays are at the top of the food pyramid and keep the whole ecosystem in balance. With the current state of fisheries, it is difficult to ensure that fishing methods are unselective. But eating lower down the food web and avoiding such predators is beneficial in more than one way. The presence of plastic in our oceans has reached critical proportions. In Goa, there's a lot we need to do at our panchayat level to ensure that our solid waste management can be adapted to the volumes of our tourism and industry. These need our support, and so do the large number of creative ventures that provide an alternate to plastic. Our society in Goa is unique in the way we participate together as a community in public life. As unplanned development damages our coastline, creeks and riverbanks, it is important for us to claim our rights for inclusive decision making as part of our civic responsibilities. We must respond to public meetings and consultations called by the government where our voice regarding drawing plans for our villages and cities on the coast and inland need to be heard. His Holiness has denounced the privatization of water resources as unacceptable, and he says that it is at the expense of the human right to have access to this good. As our traditional coastal fishing villages live on the brink of change, protecting the ocean and coast that support their livelihoods and coastal life is our moral duty and service to our beautiful Goa. Today with me, I have Aaron Savio Lobo, who is a marine conservationist with work experience in South Asia and West Africa. He has worked on sea snake diversity along the coast of Goa using trawler bycatch data. Aaron's work explores the economics of trawl fishing along the Coromandel coast. This work was the basis of his doctoral thesis, which he completed from Cambridge University in the UK. Over and above that, Aaron has a long-standing interest in finding ways to reconcile conservation and economic development through policy and practice. His work has involved designing, supporting, and implementing projects on marine protected areas, setting up fisheries monitoring programs, and undertaking environmental and social impact assessments. So I'm happy to have Aaron here today, who has dived in multiple continents. And Aaron, thanks for being on the show.
It's my pleasure, yeah.
So the Pope's message in September was a call to save the great waters and all that they contain. So as a marine biologist who has dived and worked in multiple continents, including the coasts of Goa and India, I was wondering if you could share with some of the viewers what are some of the professional and personal experiences that are different from what we see on land.
Yeah, sure. So I was trained as a marine ecologist, worked in marine conservation for several years, and in several parts of the world, you know, ranging from West Africa to India, other parts of South Asia, Southeast Asia as well. And one thing in you know, besides being a marine ecologist, I'm also someone who loves my seafood. So it's quite ironic in that sense. So there have been two things. One thing is I dived a lot, not just for work, but just to kind of, you know, do it for pleasure as well. But my work was mainly sort of examining fish catches that were caught on board trawlers, in other vessels, small scale crafts, you know, developing fisheries monitoring programs, examining fish markets. And actually many of these places provide you with a perfect lens to kind of see what's what lies underwater. And actually a view of a simple fish landing site in Goa would tell you like what kind of what would our ecosystem kind of look like. Not many of us have the luxury to be in kind of pristine waters all the time, and most of the seas are not, you know, crystal clear waters with reefs and, you know, abounding in fish life. But what they do have are people who kind of extract from the sea, and that's what you get a glimpse of. And this gave me a perfect sort of a proxy of an idea of what was found there. Now, talking in terms of similarities between land and water, if you look at the sea, just going to a coral reef, you know, I mean, you have, you know, trophic groups, as we call them in ecology, or different, you know, from predators, like say the tiger in the forest, you have sharks and groupers in the sea. You have secondary consumers, say like, you know, like your civet cats, or small carnivorous cats. You have secondary consumers like the snappers, the emperors, the grunts, a whole range of species in the sea. You have similar species to goat and deer, which kind of graze the reef flat, keeping the reef sort of clean, allowing new macroalgae to colonize. You have planktivores that feed on plankton. So they're very similar, but very interestingly, the way we treat the sea is very different from the way we treat land. We look at the sea as an inexhaustible supply of food. That's purely how we look at it. When it comes to a terrestrial ecosystem, we want to manage every bit of land. You know, we know exactly what's going to be done in one place versus the other. We've classified every patch of land. We try our best not to mismanage it. Our wildlife, you know, if you go, you know, in Goa, if you go sort of catching frogs, you could be arrested, you know, for catching frogs and consuming their legs. Even, you know, picking wild mushrooms from the forest can get you in trouble. You can land tons of fish every day. And it's still wild caught fish. It's actually wildlife, but we don't consider it wildlife. It's still food. It's very important that we look at it as food, but there is a sort of an onus on us to manage it.
So as a follow-up question, so in the September message, His Holiness said that water should not be a sign of separation of people, but an encounter of the human community. I know that he said it in the context of migration of people from across different countries. But is there a way that you think that water and the oceans have formed, given us a sense of community?
I think that's a really sort of a pertinent message in more ways than one. In fact, if you just look at our Bay of Bengal countries, you know, fishers in the Bay of Bengal, they didn't really recognize borders. Fish don't recognize borders, you know, especially in a dynamic system like an ocean where currents and meteorological conditions determine where fish move. And because of that, fishermen follow the fish. In a case where, you know, fisheries are sustainable, things are not overexploited, you have fishers kind of hugging to their coastlines. But if you just look at Indian fisheries itself, you know, Indian shelf fisheries or the fisheries that was conducted on the continental shelf has expanded in area four times since the 1960s, which is huge, you know.
Yeah.
And the reason for that is not just because fishers became, you know, more powerful to go further and further. It's mainly because they kind of depleted fish stocks and they kept going further and further. Now, when we talk about it, I mean, I can give you an example. I used to work in West Africa along the coast of Liberia, where there is a Ghanaian fishing community called the Fanti. Okay. And very interestingly, these Fanti fishermen had communities pretty much all the way down from their hometown in Ghana, all the way up the West African coast, crossing several countries. So they were just like the fish. They were following the fish. They didn't really recognize boundaries, you know. And the whole idea was to kind of keep this fishery sustainable at a regional level. You can't just look at Goa as like the whole and soul globally. It is important. We have to manage our fisheries, but it requires regional cooperation, not just from our neighboring states, but from countries even beyond our jurisdiction. Because fishing, as I said, fish move across borders.
Correct. So then as a follow-up question to what you just said about fish moving beyond borders, he went also on a recent visit to Madagascar in September, where he said there can be no true ecological approach or effective efforts to safeguard the environment without an attainment of social justice, concern for nature. And a couple of years ago, there was also an encyclical where he wrote about the inseparable bond between the marine world and issues of social justice. So do you see that there's a intersection between marine conservation and issues of social justice right there?
Absolutely. I think marine conservation is really about not protecting the sea for the sea's sake. It's about sustainable use. And the issues that have sprung up over the years, whether it's the coming in of the industrial trawl fisheries that took place in the 60s, 70s in many of our coastal states, that led to not just conflict with the small-scale fisher, but it also led to a marginalization of a certain section of society. Besides that, in many ways, you can look at it as a way of depriving people of an important source of protein. Many of fishing communities, fishery supports over 4 million people in our country, of which 1 million people are exclusive fishers. Now, many of these, even these communities, are deprived from a fish protein source. Now, fish, besides being a protein source, is a very important component to support people with their micronutrients. Okay, many of these communities suffer from hidden hunger. You know, mothers, children in their early stages require these micronutrients. So by actually having a fishery that's kind of socially just, you kind of make sure that this is accessible to the global masses where it's supposed to be accessible.
So related to the last two questions, we also then come to the question of what is the sort of political will that is required at the level of Goa and India, maybe also across national boundaries, to make fisheries more sustainable?
Yeah. So, to answer your question, very interestingly, India currently ranks second highest in its global seafood production. Now, this is not just the marine fish catch, but also stuff that is produced from the farm fishing sector, the aquaculture sector, inland fisheries, etc. So, we are a really big producer of fish globally. Whether this is sustainable, that's another question. Okay, most of our fisheries in many parts of the mainland coast of the country have been overfished. In many cases, they've been collapsed. We are seeing collapses in, small fish populations that are actually difficult to be impacted, like sardine. There was a sardine crash in Kerala about 2 years ago, and we were actually importing sardine from other countries. We have been importing stuff like kingfish, but from Korea. So it's strange. And today, because we live in a very global marketplace, what's happening is what we see in our market does not necessarily reflect what is being caught in the oceans around us. So this is something that we need to understand.
So then navigating sustainable seafood consumption is sort of difficult given these larger scale factors. So are there some general principles that you can give the viewers?
Yeah, from a very Goan, sitting in a chair in Goa, I can say one thing with pretty high level of confidence. Today, we have access to markets and to people that many other parts of the world don't have. India is actually at a very interesting position. We still buy from traditional producers or from fishmongers. That's changing fast though. We have a growing middle class population. And one big aspect of a middle-class lifestyle is a middle-class diet, which is kind of rich in protein. As a result, we're eating more fish, okay? But a couple of things that I like to say, in terms of, just quick suggestions. As far as possible, eat local. We have access to our local fishmongers. If you take a little drive along any of Goa's rivers, it's always scattered with a couple of people who sit in local places where they obtain fish from their traditional stake nets, your kutauni or your crabs from the Kobale. You can see them selling it on the bridge. You can see these big black clams, maranai, being sold in a whole bunch of places. So, get it locally. Most of the cases, they are also seasonal because you can see those people selling it seasonally. Now, this differs from those fish vans that you see throughout the year. That does not necessarily reflect what's coming from Goan waters. try and avoid eating fish during the fishing ban season or the trawl ban season. The reason for this is because most of the fish that you see in those fish vans or the marketplace is not being caught in the state because the trawlers are not fishing at that point of time. If you really have to eat fish, you know, actively source it from the backwater areas in the state. They're diverse. I mean, I've like spent like 2 months in the monsoon over a series of days, just kind of, you know, getting a whole range of species, and I came up with like something like 46 species through that monsoon period. One thing that's one of the best ways we can engage, not just with fish, but with all our food sources, you know, engage with your producers, move away from the, I mean, like it's good to see eco labels in a marketplace, but don't sort of rest on eco labels. You know, if you go to a supermarket and you say, oh, this is kind of environmentally friendly or it's fair trade, it doesn't mean much because you're not really engaging with your environment, you're not engaging with the producer. So you have to be an active consumer. That's the best advice I can possibly give in something like this, you know. Today, I think we're getting as distant as possible from our food as we ever were. And that's because we are constantly masked by these things, eco labels, you know, supermarkets. They're not necessarily bad, but, you know, we have to be active.
Okay. So, like, coming to a very specific example of our shiota, which many go and say it's our state fish and it's a love fish, but it's also shunned by a lot of people. So, and it's also, interestingly, I think one of the fish that doesn't require a trawler to basically be caught, right?
Yeah.
So are there any benefits that you feel of eating lower down in the food chain or like diversifying your diet? And what are some fish that we can get inland, like some specific examples maybe? Yeah.
I mean, the monsoons are the best time to test this out, but your example of the shota is a very good one. It became our state fish a couple of years ago, and I was really pleased with it, actually, because the shota is found all the way where the water is fairly fresh, you know, in our backwater where it gets fairly fresh, right out to sea. Now, we have a couple of species of mullet, but what's really interesting is it's accessible to pretty much everyone. It is really the fish of a common man, and that's what I love about the shota. Now, regarding the taste of the shota, if you talk to any person who truly loves his fish, I can personally tell you that I like mullets during the summer months, but I don't like shotalis during the monsoons because they're kind of tasteless. Mm. The same thing with the dodiaro, which is your croaker. Yeah. They're kind of tasteless, you know. So I like them in certain seasons. So I'm not sure whether there's a class thing associated with these fish, but there is generally a class thing associated with eating fish. You know, we generally tend to eat fish that are just, you know, plain, neat fillets, no bones. That's how people want to eat it. But actually, a lot of the tasty fish has a lot of bones. And if you really want to eat fish, you should go through the bones, you know.
Yeah.
And that's how you sort of value your food as well.
So, like, in terms of the articulation of why oceans and fish should be conserved, I was actually visited a friend of mine who's a restaurateur, and he was explaining to his son that they don't eat sharks in their house, but he explained it from a very terrestrial point of view, saying that they don't eat it because it would be like eating a tiger. So what are the challenges you think in terms of the articulation of marine conservation compared to what we have like in protecting species on land?
So I think that's a really a very nice sort of analogy that he's used. And in many ways, it's an important one. You know, both are top predators, you know, both kind of occupy a very similar position in the ecosystem. Obviously, the issues that they face are kind of very different. Over-harvest of sharks has had a big sort of a fallout on the ecosystem where there are trophic cascades, you know, there are other species that increase in abundance. They actually, they kind of keep the ecosystem health in check in many ways. So you can make these analogies, but the problems in the oceans are far more complex. Just one thing, the sheer size, you know, the dynamic state where these species can actually move across borders. They can move, you know, across ecosystems, like a big bull shark could enter the Mandovi River, found in like, you know, really low salinity and, you know, move right out to sea. So the problems of managing these highly migratory species can be actually very challenging. So the thing is, we are landlubbers and we know our terrestrial animals and trees the best, you know. So that's how we kind of explain things. But I think it's about time that we reconnect with our oceans, it's something that we've done all through our childhood. You know, we've gone fishing, we've, you know, swum in the sea, in the rivers. So I think it's time we reconnect with...
So finally, on that note of reconnect to the ocean, it also brings us back to the message of the Pope, where he calls for the younger generation to grow in knowledge and respect for our common home and the desire to care for the essential good of water for the benefit of all. So do you think that there is something that the children of Goa can do to have these greater connections with their coast and oceans?
Yeah, I actually love that message. Simply because it actually tells you, I mean, knowledge is something that you don't just pick up, you know, from your books or, you know, just watching a TV show or something like that. It's important. I mean, there's no doubt about it. But I think for me, the best thing has been actually getting out into nature and simple things like, you know, going for a swim, going to the beach, you know, just combing the shore, looking for a whole bunch of things, looking at how a starfish buries, what it eats. Taking your kids fishing. I take my son fishing every Sunday and he's got a whole diversity of things. And in fishing, it doesn't just teach you how to catch a fish. It teaches you from where to source your bait. It teaches you about the environment around you. And I think that's so important. That's one of the best ways I found of, you know, reconnecting actually. And I think it's something that's accessible to us still in Goa. And the thing is, the minute we kind of lose or alienate ourselves with these bodies and it just becomes something that, you know, we begin to theorize about, I think that's when the issues start of disconnect. You know, we need to really connect with it. You know, we really need to get into the water. We need to collect the clams with our hand. We need to break oysters a couple of times. We need to catch our fish. We need to cook our fish. I think that's super important.
So thanks, Aaron, and thanks everyone for being here. And thanks to all our viewers. And it's a great time to think about our oceans in multiple ways.